It is a honor and a pleasure to be here closing this great event with you, Mr. Commissioner. You are an institution here in Brussels, if I can say that, and I think you will be missed, assuming you're actually leaving. We'll come back to that. Everyone has waited all day for this, I'm sure. And we have a lot to cover, because your resume covers a lot. But I thought we'd jump right in. Being a newsman, I have to ask you sort of a news-related question on your current portfolio, the budget. Prime Minister Boris Johnson seems intent on crashing out of the EU if he has to. If he does, what does a hard Brexit mean for the EU budget?
If we would have an exit without any agreement, and if Boris Johnson would say, I don't pay anything after end of October, it would be no problem for the rest of the year. So budget 2019 is more or less fixed. It would mean that we are missing for our draft budget 2020 about 11 billion euro net. And the bill, what UK has to pay leaving the EU for pensionists, for projects for which we have commitments, but not yet payments. So it's a bill with more than 40 billion. And this would mean this money would not come after Brexit. So we have to realize it via cuts in our existing budgetary structure, or we have to ask member states to pay a bit more to give us a bit higher contributions. In general, the legal situation is clear, because a multi-annual financial framework has to be decided by unanimity. It was in 2012 and 13 when David Cameron and his government accepted our 7 years budget, our framework. And so it's clear they have to take part up to the end of 2020 with all obligations and rights. But if he is not willing to pay, I don't know any court over the world which is responsible for such a situation. Our best argument is, if he leaves the EU without paying, without fulfilling obligations, we never can trust him for to come to a trade agreement. And we are sure if anybody doesn't pay his bill, his rating will decrease. So it maybe is not good for his own reputation and the kingdom's reputation. But let's wait and see, you never know. My assumption is there will be an extraordinary election. And to prepare elections before to organize a campaign needs time. And if this time is needed, I think an extension after end of October would be acceptable.
Okay. I'd love to follow up, but I want to cover a lot of ground. So let's be optimistic for a moment and say there's not a hard Brexit. Coming back to the budget, this being a tech conference, Horizon and technology, what does the funding look like, and how big a difference will Horizon funding make over the next 5 years?
We see industrial sectors. We see services. We see technological developments in which just Europe can be a competitive partner. If you are analyzing ongoing Silicon Valley and China, here Alphabet, Facebook, Amazon, Google, Apple, there Huawei, Tencent, Alibaba, others. no company standalone has enough financial power, has human resources they need. Not Philips, Siemens, Bosch, and others. And no member state standalone has on the long term the budgetary power for to compete. So we need European strategies. We need a public-private partnership on a European level. 1 euro from Horizon Europe or Digital Europe, a few additional euros from member states, plus investments from our private sector. Then I'm sure, and we have concrete examples, take our robotic PPP, take our photonic and our sensoric PPP, or take our important project of common European interest seeing micro and nano electronics with Infineon, with Dresden, with Delft, and so on. For big challenges, we have to Europeanize research policies. And therefore, Horizon Europe is the right instrument, and Digital Europe, a special instrument for AI, cybersecurity, and high-performance computing in parallel. And the last sentence, we need Oxford, Cambridge, London. We need ETH Zurich and Basel. So whatever happens, we should come to an agreement in which the British and the Swiss universities and research institutions can take part. Because Oxford, Cambridge, London, they are really excellent, but they are too small, standalone. But as excellent partners in the European team, it's a win-win situation between UK and EU27 and Switzerland and others, maybe combined with the idea of European universities, networks, and assisted by Erasmus Plus and doubling or tripling Erasmus Plus, then I'm sure and quite optimistic Europe can survive and can hold a leading position where we are in lead, robotic, and we can start the process for to come back or for to be on a comparable level in fields in which we are lagging behind, as AI is.
Okay. And moving on from that, you are in the luxurious position of being able to tell the current commission what they should do, because you get to leave and it's not your problem. So what should the digital agenda for the next commission be?
Not all policies have to be Europeanized, but digital strategies need a European digital policy. Digital single market, digital union, common standards, European research and innovation projects, infrastructure, take 5G with a common time schedule, with common standards, or take automotive and autonomous driving. To drive a car, a truck is per se a continental dimension, because national borders are not relevant, more or less, for mobility. So data flow or standards for cybersecurity are really key. I'm convinced digital policies have to be nearly completely Europeanized.
President-elect von der Leyen seems to be making a Green New Deal for Europe a central part of her agenda. She's talked about mobilizing €1 trillion. How realistic is this?
If you see a decade, 1,000 billion is a lot, but if projects are smart and not ideological, it's a realistic amount of money for investments. Take broadband, fiber, and 5G. When I was responsible for digital, we calculated which investments are needed for to have a real future-proof digital infrastructure for all over Europe. It's about 500 billion. And we calculated 80%, 85% have to come from private investors, from the market. But for to attract some investments in rural areas and so on, you need public funding or new instruments as guarantees or loans are in addition or instead of grants. So the digital sector is speaking about hundreds of billions. If you take other sectors, so a really modernized railway system, one example, Rail Baltica, via connecting Europe facility, we want to integrate our railway system from Finland via Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania to Poland up to Hamburg and Rotterdam. So 1,000 billion, it's a lot. But if you take several sectors in which we need investments, it's ambitious but realistic. And therefore we need European budget and member states budget, but we need EIB and national promotional banks as well. We need a set of best instruments from grants to loans to guarantees. And then I think this is a European vision coming from von der Leyen, which is ambitious, but again, realistic.
Okay. Moving from the big picture to a slightly smaller picture, and one important to your home state in Baden-Württemberg, industry, manufacturing, one of Europe's great strengths, but a lot of it is older technologies, and a lot of manufacturers face a big challenge in digitization, the cloud. Is Europe ready? Are companies adapting as quickly as they should, and what do they need at the enterprise level?
In Germany, the Industry 4.0 network started 5 years ago. Meanwhile, we have 18, 20 comparable networks in many European member states. And we created a platform of platforms. So it sees 18, 20 working together on an European level. My analysis is, the majority of our companies is ready, is seeing the challenge, is using digital technologies, is coming more and more to a own big data strategy. In the factory, we are very good. The more we come to the consumer, so platform strategy, social media, but even using data from consumers, from contracting parts and so on, we are lagging behind. I met the Director General of the Bayerische Rundfunk, Wilhelm, together with others last days. We have to think about how to leverage our European digital sovereignty. I think we should use social media coming from the US. We should use platforms coming from the US. But we should think about, couldn't we have some own competencies for to decrease our dependence and for to leverage our European digital sovereignty?
Broadly, looking back at the past 5 years, what would you say were the most significant accomplishments, you and the Commission, and what are the areas that you have the most let's say, regrets or wish that you could have done more and the commission could have done more?
Last decade, from the financial markets crisis in 2009-10-11, seeing Greece, Ireland, Portugal, Cyprus, even Spain coming to Brexit, many analysts and many market players have been saying this EU will die. Brexit is a blueprint for others. Our ECB and our umbrellas for member states as Ireland and Greece have been, this will be a window in which Europe will be an union without an own and common future. Meanwhile, okay, Brexit, but nobody will follow. I'm sure the example of UK is a perfect example for to avoid any next exit. Even some difficult partners, Hungary, never ever say no, a single market, same standards, being a team is better than to be stand alone. So I'm quite optimistic that we are coming to an end of a difficult decade without being destroyed, being more or less back again. But now it's about competitiveness. And let me say, no doubt, if Great Britain or after exit Little England is more competitive, has more economic power than EU27, then we would have a problem. Mm-hmm. So I wish UK all the best, but I wish that we are much more competitive.
Okay. Just the last couple of questions. First one, the European Commission is a very serious institution. But when you all get together as the 13th floor of the Berlaymon, are there any moments that you remember over the past decade where you laughed, where it was funny? You know, did Jean-Claude Juncker crack a joke? Does it ever get funny up there?
May I mention three examples? First of all, it's always a surprise whom he's kissing and how long. Wednesday at 9 o'clock a.m., we have our weekly college meeting from 9 up to 1:30. He is entering the room a bit later, 30, 40 minutes later, kissing normally everybody. All 27 colleagues, legal service, our translation people, it needs time. But if he is not willing to kiss you, you have a problem. So it's about politics. And afterwards at 1:30 we have a working lunch together. Normally I don't eat at this time, and I never have been drinking Bordeaux at this time. For me, in Baden-Württemberg, it was Trollinger at the evening and Bordeaux Sunday. But every working day Bordeaux, one glass, two glasses, or three, was a new experience. I think Ursula doesn't drink alcohol, so she has a challenge. And looking back, when we negotiated between Ukraine and the Russian Federation and Uktransgaz and Gazprom for to avoid a blockade in our European gas markets, the Russian partners, the Ukrainian partners came to Brussels, it was okay. They did accept this place. But progress, much more was made when I developed the idea to invite them to Berlin, or even better, to Vienna. Here in our premises, in our Bellarmine, progress was not so easy. Having been in Berlin or having been in Vienna, they have been much more constructive, did accept each other in a better dimension. So I think politics and to come to a compromise needs a super friendly and comfortable environment, as this embassy is for DLD. Okay.
I'll wrap up with, I polled a few people today of what I should ask you, and the suggestion that came up most often was, ask him what he's doing next. So, what's next?
Next is Butter Night.
Okay. I will rephrase the question. November 2nd.
If no candidate is rejected, but maybe can be the case, then indeed, November 1st, I'm out of office. Yeah. And I don't want to be a pensionist. I would prefer to be a team member of the VfB Stuttgart. They are playing in the second German league, but I am too old and not fast enough. And I want to found an own company. I'm coming from the tax consultants. I'm a tax lawyer. I want to get go back to private sector. I have several ideas. I am flexible, not here in Brussels. I want to come back to Brussels for to see my friends, but not for to work. And my decision has to be taken in October.
Okay. I think the last panel would love to help you get you help lobbying on stock options, because that's a big issue that was just discussed. So, Commissioner Oettinger, it's a real pleasure. You will be missed here. And I'd like to thank everybody on behalf of DLD. Steffi, are you going to close things out? But Commissioner, thank you so much.